Belinda presents this unabridged recording of growing great kids, helping them become as good as they can be. Written by Father Chris Riley with Sue Williams and read by Father Chris Riley and David Tredinnick.
To all the board members of Youth Off the Streets who have served over many years, gratitude to them for believing in what I do and enabling us to continue our work with children and young people and trying to make the world a better place for them.
Part 1. Growing Great Kids.
Chapter 1. Growing Great Kids. Childhood should be a carefree time for kids, full of the wonder and the joy of discovery while living in the security of a good home with great parents. It should also be the highlight of adults' lives, sharing the fun and guiding kids on their own path to explore the world and fulfill their fabulous potential. But for too many children and their parents, the reality is sadly very different. What should be an exciting, rewarding, and exceptionally happy meeting of the ways too often turns into an exhausting, depressing, and casualty-strewn battlefield in the teenage years. While every age can be difficult for both sides, adolescence is easily the most turbulent time of most young people's lives, and by default, those of their parents or guardians. That's when young people are undergoing rapid physical changes, and they're on a roller coaster of different moods. They're emotional and their hormones are going haywire. At the same time, they're trying to work out who they are and what they want, to forge their own identity for themselves and in the eyes of others, and to be accepted. As a result, teenagers will often take risks without thinking through the consequences, experiment with new things, and rebel against the people in their lives they see as authority figures, usually their parents, first of all. Sometimes it seems like almost overnight they turn from loving, happy, chatting children into sullen, silent, moody strangers. It's no surprise that so many adults say they're nervous about bringing up teenagers, find it difficult to maintain an open relationship with them, and worry about how they'll manage and how their teens will turn out. But in the 40 years I have worked with about 150,000 troubled young people, including some of the toughest kids with the most dangerous and complex issues there could be, I know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that I've never encountered a kid who was born bad. Bad behaviour is created later by bad circumstances, bad situations, and bad environments. One very powerful factor that can lead to create a bad environment is our expectations of teenagers. In short, if we expect the worst from teenagers, then they'll most likely deliver. As one boy said to me, "If you expect me to throw tantrums, then I will. I'll break all your windows. If you think I'm violent, yep, that's what I'll be." Negative expectations and labels are dangerous and create self-fulfilling prophecies. If, on the other hand, we change the expectations we have of teenagers, then we'll usually be rewarded over and over again. I'll always remember walking into a gang clubhouse a few years ago to be confronted by a group of very aggressive-looking young men covered in tattoos, dressed in black leather and all scowling at me. My first instinct was the same as anyone else's might have been, to beat a hasty retreat. Instead, I smiled, said hello, politely thanked them for seeing me and held out my hand. Immediately their faces broke into beams and they rushed around to find me a chair, then sat down with me to talk over some of the events that were happening in the neighbourhood. It was a meeting that started the process of completely changing the atmosphere in that suburb. It also reinforced for me a valuable lesson about not judging young people by their looks, by societal stereotypes, or by our own preconceptions and prejudices. We adults have a responsibility to treat young people as we'd like to be treated, with respect, with dignity, and with kindness. We need to have the courage to expect greatness in our young. We should see all kids as people of promise. We must believe that goodness is in all children. And it's important we work to develop environments where kids can flourish, learn generosity, and end up playing a valuable role in the world. It's a big job, but it's one of the most important jobs we as adults will ever have. In fact, traditional Native American wisdom holds that the only reason adults even exist is to raise children, and that raising children is the responsibility of every adult. After all, it's so much simpler to prevent a young person going off the rails than it is to deal with the torturous fallout afterwards, which can include binge drinking, drugs, bullying, violence, crime, homelessness, broken dreams, and ultimately hopelessly shattered lives. As African American hero Frederick Douglass, a former slave who ran for US vice president and became one of the country's leading thinkers, once said, "It is easier to build strong children than to repair broken men." It's therefore our task as adults in the community, as parents, as guardians, as teachers, as aunts and uncles, as people who care to support young people through their most challenging years, to keep them engaged, to let them know they're valued, to listen to them, to encourage them, and to provide them with opportunities to grow and realize their full potential. Hopefully they'll grow into great kids without too many problems, but youngsters even from the best families can go off the rails, and the most wonderful parents in the world can't always protect their children from harm. There are basic fundamental principles and processes in parenting that apply to everyone and promise the best possible chances of success. Following these has helped parents and their teens in some of the worst possible times and made the best moments all the more precious. In this book, we'll go through them one by one, carefully explaining their significance, how they work, and how best to implement and act on them. Of course, it won't always be easy. No one can promise that. But years of research, and even more years of looking after young people and helping them through their problems, have shown me that these are the tried and tested ways and offer the very best way forward. Of all these, however, caring for adolescents and caring about them, no matter what, is the number one cardinal rule and the one single element that makes the most difference to a child or a young person's life. I particularly like the idea American developmental psychologist Yuri Bronfenbrenner put forward, that every child needs at least one person who is irrationally crazy about him or her. It's important they have an absolute minimum of one fan, someone who believes in them, whatever's going on around them. Try it with a teenager you know. Once you've started, you'll discover it really isn't that hard. Celebrating and supporting some of the wonderful young people, both children and teenagers who live in our communities, is the important first step to truly growing great kids.
Chapter 2. Turbulent Teens. I was once told by one of Australia's most powerful politicians that the problem with teenagers was that they were detaching themselves from adults and parents. I suggested to her that it was probably the other way round. Adults were detaching themselves from young people. For kids, their priorities are simple. They're hardwired to please adults. They just want connections, recognition, and validation. You see the evidence time and time again. I've watched as teenagers who've been abused in the most terrible ways imaginable by their parents still choose to go back to live with them and remain heartbreakingly loyal, even though the personal cost to them is horrendous. Our kids want adults to be part of their lives and need us to be closely involved, whether they show it or not. Research backs that up constantly. There have been many studies over the years showing that parents and guardians occupy a unique and critical place in the networks of young people, even though a lot of us don't realise that or feel uncomfortable with being placed in that exalted position. US pioneer psychotherapist Virginia Satir, known as the mother of family therapy, tried to explain why, saying that adults are sometimes unsure enough of themselves and their role in society, let alone being looked to for guidance by impressionable young people. Adolescents are just people trying to learn how to make it among the adults in the world, she said, who are probably not so sure themselves. While it's a big responsibility, it's up to adults to front up and take that on. They also need to recognise that life is a lot different now from when most of us grew up. In the old days, a parent just shouted at a child and expected immediate obedience. Now kids are a great deal more sophisticated and complex, with a lot more stresses and demands on their attention and time. We also know a lot more about what makes them tick. In order to rise to this task of helping kids, and to become the best carers of adolescents we possibly can, we need first to understand a little of their psychological development. Kid psychology. Kids can be incredibly frustrating to adults. In some ways, they can be smart, resourceful, and intelligent, but then they mystifyingly let themselves and other people down with depressing frequency. But there's now a whole field of science dedicated to looking at the changes that occur in children's brains as they grow, and it makes behaviour that adults often misinterpret as deliberately disruptive infinitely more reasonable and understandable. One youngster I came across in the classroom, Michael, is a good example. He was always in strife, and it was difficult for his teachers to comprehend why he didn't seem able to follow the simplest of instructions, and why, no matter how many times he was told, he'd never have the right books with him for his various classes. He'd always be the one who'd lost his homework, his jacket, his bag, his money. Some teachers thought he failed to listen or was purposely obstructive. How could he possibly be so hopeless when it came to organising himself? But when I talked to him about his early life, suddenly everything about him started to make sense. He'd been only 6 months old when his parents split up, and he was left with a father who just couldn't cope with either the marital breakdown or the demands of a small child. He was neglected for many years, until he was finally taken into foster care at the age of 10. He still failed to thrive, and his foster carers became impatient at how he seemed to deliberately ignore their instructions and with his erratic behaviour. He was moved through 5 different foster homes until he finally became homeless. With this background fully understood, we had a psychologist help him, and now he's making great progress, learning how to process the kind of simple tasks most of us take for granted every day. These days, we know more about the human brain than ever before, and realise that adolescent brains are still developing, changing, and being shaped by their environment right up to the age of 25. As a result, all through the teenage years, the brain is still a work in progress. This has implications for a whole range of abilities, including motor skills, cognitive development, problem solving, and moral and conceptual understanding, language acquisition, social personality and emotional development, and self-concept and identity formation. The parts of the brain undergoing the most dramatic change in the teenage years are the frontal lobe and hippocampus, areas associated with motivation, impulse control, and addiction. This is hard, irrefutable science, not opinion, speculation, or theory. Through techniques like magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, we've learned there's a wave of tissue growth during early childhood, followed by substantial remodeling throughout adolescence. This second set of changes is mostly about improvements to the connections between the nerves that make the brain's operation more efficient, particularly in regions associated with regulating our emotions and behaviour. Development psychologists believe that some young people's brains do not refine themselves as well as they should because of the environment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.